familiar, I won't be here. So he needs no introduction. But for somebody who's born in 94, 23 years old, he's one of my heroes, and he is always one of those person that I look up to. And recently he has another paper called Interactive Coin Offering, which look at the bidding methods. And I think the deepness is not only the scale of the technology, the deepness of the knowledge is also in the cryptography and the style of academic writing. And I've been an academic or half-time academic since 1990, when I first graduated PhD. And I can tell you the style of writing of the ICO, the Interactive Coin Offering paper, is world-class academic standard. And this is a very good combination of lifelong learning, which we're promoting here at SUSS, together with the real recognition building. And this is a hero that we have, and in Mandarin, I call him Sen Tong. And in Mandarin, they call him V Sen. V for Vitalik, Sen is God. And he's really the V God of the crypto world. And as usual, when I say that, you know, and without further ado, and we don't want to wait so long, I just have one request that take as many photos as you can while he's on stage. Please do not crowd around him and take a personal photo, because I think out of respect for him, please give him a bit of privacy out there. We are all in the crypto world, so privacy is key to so give a bit of privacy and allow him to have some private space. And I just ask him to come on stage. He's going to do half an hour of talk, and then he'll be opening to questions for you. So we'll get the questions prepared. And let us put our hands together to welcome our Visa. To hold you back a little bit more. We have the SUSS fellows, we have about 60 or 70 of them who actually help the university and to recognize their contribution to the university. We call them SUSS fellows. And today it's a great honor to have you here. So I'm going to invite the Dean Li Kui-man to on stage to give the plug to Vitalik. Give it to you for thank you for contribution to the university and helping us to build a community of crypto economy over here in the university. So, Dean, this is the Dean. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dean Li. So, Vitalik, all yours.
Yeah, so, and thank you, D-God, for the introduction. D for decentralization. So, what I wanted to start off with is kind of give my introduction to kind of what I think some of the important properties are that of blockchain technology, and specifically in the context of what are some of the specific traits that blockchains have that make them good for building applications and building systems that are inclusive. So, you know, like, what is it about the idea of decentralization? What is it about blockchains as a technology specifically that, you know, like, actually makes them a very good fit for, you know, the kinds of people that and the kinds of ideas that are that are striving to make the world a more inclusive place. Then, and after that, I'm also going to go into some of the more technical details and basically just give an idea of what I think some of the technical obstacles that, you know, if there still are in the blockchain space that we are still working on, but also once again, in this context of, you know, in what way are these technical barriers actually hindering people from building things in the space or hindering people from using things that are built on top of blockchains? So basically, in what ways are technical challenges excluding people, and how can we fix them? Two forward. Next. So the two kind of properties of blockchains that I often like to focus on is, first of all, I like to focus on the idea that blockchains are decentralized systems. So a blockchain is a system that's not controlled by any one person, not controlled by any one organization, not controlled by any one country. And also blockchains are networks that have a memory. And I think both sides to this definition are important because even for many decades before we've had blockchains, we've had plenty of systems that had one of these things but not the other. So decentralized things without a memory, there's plenty of them. I mean, BitTorrent, a peer-to-peer network, existed for at least 10 years before Bitcoin. Skype, the very earliest versions of Skype were actually pretty close to a peer-to-peer messaging system. So decentralized networks by themselves were something that people were thinking about for a long time. And there are definitely a lot of reasons why people were thinking about decentralized networks in that context, right? Decentralized systems can be more reliable, can be more secure, they can be more resistant against various types of attacks, but this is only one piece of the puzzle, right? So we've seen decentralized applications for in a lot of different areas, but the one thing that people in kind of cypherpunks, who are thinking about decentralization, kind of open source, free software, even way back before this whole blockchain thing started, we're thinking about, that proves to be much harder than the other problems, is how can we make a decentralized peer-to-peer digital currency? And it turns out that this is one specific problem that's harder than a lot of other problems for one particular reason. And the reason is that implementing a currency requires a memory, right? So this is the other and a very important part of definition of a blockchain that, as I see it. So we've had systems with memory for a long time. So if you use any kind of just regular traditional bank account, well, there's some computer somewhere that stores what your account balance is. Now, it is a centralized system, but it is a system, it has a memory, and it keeps track of how much money you have. Now, why do we need some kind of common shared memory in order to maintain a system of money? Why can't we just have everyone remember by themselves how much money they have, right? So, here's the basic problem. Suppose that we tried to make some kind of this form of digital currency just purely on top of communication. So let's say that we have a system where I have some kind of encrypted digitally signed thing that said that I have 100 digital dollars. I then sign a transaction that sends those 100 digital dollars to one person. I then sign another transaction that sends the exact same 100 digital dollars to another person. Now, either of those two transactions is totally valid by itself, but let's say you had a system that did not have the ability to remember things. Well, the system would see one transaction, and it would think it's valid. It would see the other transaction, and it would also think that it's valid. And so what you've just done is you've turned 100 digital dollars into 200 digital dollars. Now, you might think, yay, great, free money, we don't pay taxes anymore. But if you were to try to solve it this way, then the digital dollar would hyperinflate faster than Zimbabwe. So, this is something called the double spending problem that I'm sure many of you have heard of. And this was the original context in which the idea behind a blockchain was created, right? So basically, the problem that it was trying to solve is, how do we have a system that does remember, a system that does keep track of the fact that, yes, this coin was already spent, and so you do not have it anymore, and you cannot spend it again, but do so in a way that does not reintroduce some kind of centralized authority. Next. One more. Yes, one more. Okay, so basically, now, as it proved to be the case, and as we all realized over the next 2 years, it turns out that cryptocurrency is only the first app, right? So what kinds of applications make sense to go on a blockchain? Well, what are the properties of a blockchain? Blockchains are decentralized, and blockchains have a memory. So what things make sense to put on a blockchain? Things that need decentralization, and things that need to remember stuff. And specifically, things that need to have a memory where this memory is common and shared across a large group of people. So not just shared separately by each person, but shared and remembered collectively by everyone. And there's actually lots of different examples of this. So the kind of most popular number two use case of blockchains is either domain name registries, or more generally, this kind of concept of registries, right? So domain name registries are probably the simplest example to understand. So let's say that I decide I am going to register a new website, let's say Vitalik.com, and I register it. Then a year later, someone wants to impersonate me. And so they go through the exact same process, and they try to register Vitalik.com again. Well, clearly, the first time the operation is done, it should succeed. And the second time the operation is done, it should fail. But from the point of view of someone who only came online, who only joins the system after the second operation, they don't see which of the two came first. All they see is, well, one person tried to sign up, and another person also tried to sign up. So if you want to have a system that does what it should, if you want to have a system that accepts my first attempts to register the website and rejects the second attempts to register it 1 year later, well, you need a system with a memory. So there's actually a lot of these different cases like this. So for example, let's say we want to do a decentralized exchange, and I place an order, and two people try to claim the order at the same time. Or let's say I place an order, and I change my mind, and I decide to cancel the order. But at the same time as I cancel the order, someone else claims the order. There's a very large classes of applications where this problem of what happened first and what are the consequences of one thing or the other thing happening first is something that needs to be resolved, and it needs to be resolved in a way that people have consensus on. So this is what memory is for. Now, the second and more interesting part of this is, what is decentralization for? So why is decentralization valuable for making our society more inclusive? Next. So the way I see it, there's kind of several different angles to this. Now, the first angle is the obvious one, which is security. So, a lot of the time, people in the blockchain space talk about this idea of Byzantine fault tolerance. And what this basically means is that you can have a network, and this network might contain 100 computers, and the network has the property that even if someone were to attack the network and break into even 30 of the computers, no matter what they did with those 30 computers, no matter what messages they would force those 30 computers to send, the entire network as a whole would still keep on functioning, and it would satisfy all of the guarantees that it's expected to satisfy. So you can create networks which are resilient wholes out of totally not resilient parts. And this by itself is something which is already extremely valuable. Now, why is it valuable? Well, basically because it allows us to create an infrastructure that provides a very high level of security, but also do so much more cheaply than it's possible to do in a lot of other cases. Next. So what does this lead to? Well, it leads to lower barriers to entry. So let's suppose that blockchains did not exist. And let's say you wanted to build an app, and your app basically was just an app for just selling digital trading cards. So let's say you had five digital trading cards and you wanted to sell each of them for $20. And you wanted to create a system that just does this automatically, and you don't want people to steal your trading cards. So you want the system to be secure. Well, how would you do it? Would you even be able to do it, practically speaking, in a way that's highly resistant to getting hacked? Well, it's actually a very difficult problem. But if you just stick the application on the blockchain, then the cost of putting the application on the blockchain, the cost of uploading what's called a smart contract, uploading the computer program that implements and executes and enforces the rules of what you want to build, is something that basically only costs probably less than a dollar and maybe less than 50 cents. Now, what do you get? Well, you get the benefit of whatever application you built running on a global network consisting of 25,000 computers all around the world with basically the same guarantees of security protecting the smallest application as what you get protecting applications that are managing millions of dollars of funds. So, this fact that we have this blockchain as this kind of large and kind of common resource that's just very available to everyone, acts as an equalizer. It basically means that even just regular common developers now, at least in the for the specific problem of making applications that are secure, have access to the same level of quality, the same level of access to the level of technology as even large corporations. And this already is a step forward for inclusiveness. Now, the important thing here is that a lot of the time when people make the discussion about blockchains for inclusiveness, they often talk about inclusiveness for users. Right, so basically, you might talk about how you can build systems to do things like giving identities to refugees in the Middle East or Africa, just basically give people access to some form of bank account, create some kind of microfinance system. And inclusiveness to users is very, very important. But the other kind of inclusiveness that I think blockchains are very good at, and that's probably talked about a bit less, is inclusiveness to developers. So basically, it's not just that more people can participate as consumers, but also that more people can participate as producers and as builders. And so the kind of online slogan here is not just bank the unbanked, but help the unbanked become bankers. And this actually is one of the benefits that I could see coming out of this in some cases. Now, also, another one is, blockchains cut down trust barriers, right? Now, what do we mean by trust barriers? Now, of course, there's different kinds of trust, and there's also different kinds of distrust. Now, right now, I would say that the fact that it's difficult to trust people in some cases is one of the reasons why a lot of stuff always ends up going through large companies large organizations or large countries. Basically, large entities just are already trusted, they're predictable, everyone knows what they're going to do. Now, they may still do things like collude to fix the interest rate, but they're not going to just disappear one day and steal all of your money. So, blockchain-based applications, what you can do is you can build systems where you can reduce the extent to which you even need to trust any one particular organization's reputation in the first place. And basically, instead, you can trust computer programs, and you can trust that a computer program will execute in the way that it's specified that it's going to execute. And this, once again, is another kind of accessibility, another kind of inclusiveness, and particularly another kind of inclusiveness to developers. Anyone can build applications that people will be able to trust, even if that person themselves is not someone that people already trust. So this is another benefit. Next. Also social scalability. So if we want to go from applications that work within the context of one industry, within the context of one company, or within the context of one country, and scale out from there, then we need applications where the reason, the story for why the application can be trusted does not depend on trusting one particular organization, one particular institution, one particular entity. Instead, it depends on the rules of the organization, or sorry, the rules of the application, and you know, the laws of mathematics, the laws of cryptography, and the economic incentives that are baked in as part of the rules of the system. So these are things that you know, are much easier to universalize. You may not trust people in Guatemala, but you may trust that math works in the same way in Guatemala as it does in Singapore. You can even trust that people in Guatemala like money the same way that people like money in other places. So, you know, basically with a combination of you know, systems that run on economic incentives and systems that run on math and cryptography, they are just naturally much easier to scale. Next. So, the key principle is basically this. Realistically, a blockchain application is not going to be the computationally most efficient way to get anything done. For any application that you can do on a blockchain, where you have 20,000 server computers if it's a public blockchain, maybe 5 computers to 100 computers if it's a private blockchain verifying some transaction, you can always make it more efficient by replacing that with just having one computer verifying all those transactions. Now what blockchains do is they have higher computational costs, but they do this in order to achieve this trade-off that they rely much less on social coordination costs. So what does this mean, right? I mean, I can give one practical example. So over the last couple of years, and probably especially even more in 2014 and 2015, you know, the idea of private blockchains has gotten fairly popular. And sometimes by private blockchains, they mean kind of semi-decentralized consortium chains. And sometimes when people say private blockchain, they basically just mean a centralized server with a bit more cryptography attached. So now, I've talked to at least two companies who have basically both told me a similar story. And the story is, at first, they believed that private blockchains are obviously a much more pragmatic and a realistic solution for institutions and enterprises. It's obviously much more efficient. It's obviously has like better properties in terms of them being able to control the application. And they just started building their application just on top of whatever private chain solution they wanted to make. Possibly even they wanted to make their own solution so they could sell it and make lots of money. And at first, this seems to go okay, and they would often find some large corporate partner, some corporate champion that would be willing to be a first customer. And I guess since we're in Singapore, we can probably pick on someone a bit more distant. Let's say Samsung, right? So let's say someone makes a private chain, and we'll say it's something for the supply chain industry. And Samsung signs up as basically being the first major user. And so what happens, right? At first things go well, but then they decide that, well, if we want to make the blockchain application be useful, we have to start expanding it out to beyond just Samsung. We have to start finding other users. And the feedback that they get is they actually start getting a hard time scaling beyond being just Samsung because everyone else interprets their system as just being Samsung chain. And they have a hard time shaking off the impression that if they participate in the system, then they'll just be kind of vassals of a system that's controlled by Samsung and Samsung plus this kind of dinky startup that's basically their vassal is going to just end up having the ability to change the rules later on in whatever way they want. So, with a private chain application, they actually start having trouble just being able to convince people that this is not going to happen. Now, this isn't the problem that's going to happen for each and every single use case. Sometimes, for many use cases, this problem is quite not happening. But I will say that at least two times, basically on at two occasions, I actually literally have had people basically come to me with this exact story. And at that point, they realize, wait, maybe some kind of a solution that incorporates elements of the public chain might actually be the right approach. So this is where public chains come in, right? They have higher computational costs, but because they have the benefits that with a public chain, you can build applications where the application is not just being verified by a small group of people, but where the rules are being verified and executed by a much larger group.